Pleased to chair this session where we have three papers in the robotics track. The first paper is by Satish Kumar, Johnny Jung, and Sven Koenig from the University of Southern California, and it will be presented by Satish.
Okay. All right, so welcome everyone. So this paper is about construction robots and a planning algorithm for them. So here's a quick roadmap of the talk. I'm going to begin by introducing to all of you the Harvard Thermos robots. And then I'm going to speak about how this is going to be a great example of what planning folks can do for the robotics area. And then I'm going to speak about some failures that we met with when we tried to do this. But I'm also going to speak about how we revived planning for the Thermos robots using a novel tree-based dynamic programming algorithm. And I'm going to show you some empirical results and finally conclude with some remarks on future work. All right, so the Harvard Thermos project. So this is an initiative at Harvard University in Radhika Nagpal's group. And what it is schematically is basically a bunch of small robots like this you see here and a reservoir of blocks. The robots and the blocks are roughly of the same size. And these robots are equipped with wegs instead of wheels, which makes them move on smooth surfaces as well as relatively rougher terrain without having to do anything special. For that matter, they can even help them climb these blocks, one block height at a time, once again, without having to do anything special, just because they have wegs instead of wheels. And they also have a single actuator arm that helps them, you know, kind of plug it into one of these blocks and lift them up, carry them around, and put them in another position. These are the only basic operations that these robots do. But then they do them so well that really much of the uncertainties that we have associated with manipulation or localization are not really prevalent in this domain. So one can conceive of them as being able to do high-level task planning, right, without having to worry about the errors in motion planning. I'm going to show you a little clip here to kind of ground this. So these robots in action. All right, here you see an example of one of these Thermos robots that is carrying these blocks and building a staircase. All right, so it takes this block. Notice how it plugged its single actuator robotic arm into it and carried it to the last column there and put it there. And this is supposed to be the reservoir of blocks. All right. And the one thing that I want you to notice at this point of time is that as it is stacking this last column higher and higher, it really needs to stand up on the adjacent column in order to do that, because it cannot scale very large heights. I mean, it has to do it only one at a time. So it's really constructing this ramp so that it can stand taller and taller on them. Okay? All right. So I'm going to stop it here. All right, so what can planning do for us in this domain? Well, clearly a lot, because suspiciously this resembles the blocks world domain, right? So the Thermos domain resembles the blocks world domain. So clearly we have something to offer from the planning community. And also because as they currently stand, the Thermos robots are behavior based. So it would be great if we can give them a very strong planning component, right? And the other thing I want you to notice here is that really it was a team effort in the previous schematic diagram. And if one can conceive of a team of a bunch of robots helping us in this kind of a construction task. And yes, the execution of a plan can be paralyzed, but then it has to be done under proper coordination. The robots cannot be running into each other. So multi-agent path planning and coordination is also a problem that is of interest to this community, so here is yet another place where we can contribute. But I just want to make this assumption clear that for the rest of this talk, we will assume a single robot, okay? Okay, this does not necessarily make the problem trivial, but I just want to make this assumption clear at this point. So now we want to construct, you know, arbitrary structure. So a user specifies a big structure, much larger than the robots, and now you have to come up with a plan for constructing these in the most efficient way. So let's look at some, what happened here? So let's look at, let's review some of the basic actions that they're capable of. When a robot is standing on a column like this, it can go up a block or down a block, or it can stay at the same level, okay? How about addition and removal of blocks? When it is carrying a block, it can put that block in on a tower that is in front of it, provided, again, that tower stands at the same level. While removing a block, once again, the block to be removed can be picked up as far as it is standing at the same level as the robot, okay? So these are the basic actions possible schematically. These are the only actions possible. And let's look at some simple tasks. So let's say that we want to build this column here in blue. Now, how do we do it? We cannot simply stack up the blocks one on top of each other because the robots cannot scale these heights. Instead, we have to construct it in conjunction with this ramp that I show in yellow. And then after that, I totally deconstruct this ramp. Okay? So that leads to a quadratic number of operations just for this single column. So how about constructing two towers that stand kind of next to each other but with a gap in between? Well, you could have constructed ramps individually for both of them and deconstructed them later on, but you can also share a ramp. Okay, that's a better way. So now the question becomes, can we construct much more arbitrary structures like this, you know, something like the model of the Empire State Building or the Disney Hall, and can we cast it as planning problems so that we can come up with optimal solutions or even cost-effective solutions for doing those? All right, so what we noticed was that when we cast these as planning problems and try to make use of the domain-independent planners for them, then these planners don't work well on this termist domain at all. And the reason for that is basically twofold. First of all, the ramps are constructed and deconstructed too many times, all right? And that increases the number of operations and blocks by a large factor. And to make matters worse, it would be a mistake to think that this is just a simple variant of the blocks world domain. Because really, every time there's a block operation that's going on, I also have to provide to you the sequence of actions that lead this robot to this vantage point in order to execute this action, right? So that makes the plan length enormously large. All right, so what can we do to salvage some of the planning techniques for the termist domain? So what we have done here is proposed a tree-based dynamic programming algorithm. So the idea here is that it has an inner loop and an outer loop. In an inner loop, we use the principle of dynamic programming that works on a tree, all right? And this tree spans the footprint of the user-specified structure. And in an outer loop, we search for a good tree to furnish for the inner loop, all right? And together, the algorithm provides for a framework for exploiting the locality principle. So what is the locality principle? It's the intuitive observation that distant parts of a building are somewhat unrelated to each other, or largely unrelated. But I mean, not completely independent, but largely unrelated. So somehow we want to leverage that computationally, and this scheme of doing dynamic programming on a tree that spans the footprint of the building is the way to do it. So let me illustrate some of the key concepts in the algorithm using a running example here. So what I have here is a two-dimensional input matrix where the numbers indicate the heights of the towers that need to be standing there in the final configuration. So this is representative of a small castle with a central tower of height 3 and a border of height 1, all right? So in the first stage of my inner loop, I'm going to create some spanning tree. Not necessarily the optimal one, it's just for illustration purposes. So some spanning tree that spans the footprint of this matrix. Then here the node S is representing the reservoir of blocks, All right? And intuitively, the robots are going to be restricted to run around only along the edges of the tree while placing the blocks. All right? So in the next stage, what I do is have the same tree that we had before, except rendered as a data structure. All right? So here the nodes are annotated with numbers. What do these numbers correspond to? They correspond to the same height annotations that you had before. For example, N33 is annotated with 3. Why so? Because N33 here had in the final configuration a tower of height 3. All right, so next step is to convert these numerical annotations to list annotations. So in this step, what I'm going to do is these nodes are going to be annotated with entire lists. So let's look at some of the properties of these lists. So the first number in each list is a 0. That corresponds to the fact that we're starting from an empty configuration. The last number in each list is equal to the height annotation. So for example, in this list, the last number is 3, which corresponds to this 3 here. And the length of the list for any parent node is at most 1 greater than the length of the list of a child node. Right? So this one, for example, parent node, has a length of list 4, which is at most 1 more than the child node's list of length 3. Right? And if you look inside any list, the numbers form intervals which are alternatingly non-decreasing and non-increasing. For example, 0 to 2 is non-decreasing, 2 to 0, non-increasing. Here, 0 to 0 qualifies as non-decreasing. The next 0 to 0 also qualifies as non-increasing. 0 to 1 is non-decreasing, and so forth. So these are, you know, alternate phases which intuitively capture waves. Okay, the first wave is going to add blocks to the structure. The second wave is going to remove blocks from the structure. Third wave, add blocks to the structure, and so forth. Okay? And there's a simple, you know, dynamic programming, recursive algorithm, whatever you want to call it, to work these lists out. I mean, it just recurses down the tree. So for example, if you look at this one, 0, 3, and 0, 1, the way this one is built is essentially to support the building its child nodes. Right, so the 2 here really represents the fact that I need a tower of size 2 to support a tower of size 3 while adding a block to N33. All right, so in the next stage, I'm going to build a series of event trees that fall out of these lists. So the first event tree corresponds to taking the first interval from each node, and the second event tree corresponds to taking the second interval from each node, and so forth. So here is the first event tree. Now, notice that this tree has a macrostructure as well as a microstructure. In its macrostructure, it has these supernodes that look suspiciously like the original nodes from the tree. So N15, for example, corresponded exactly to this N15. Okay? So supernodes instead of nodes. But what do the real nodes represent in this tree? The real nodes represent all possible values in the first intervals. So for example, in N33, 0 to 3, so there are 4 possible values, 0, 1, 2, and 3. They're simply listed out here, 0, 1, 2, and 3. How about the edges? The edges here are just a support structure. For example, you know, the 3 here has an edge to the 2 in its parent supernode. Intuitively, the reason being that in order for me to increase the height of N33 to 3, by adding a block, then the current height of the tower at its parent supernode must be 2. Right? And now I claim that when I do a depth-first ordering of these nodes and count only the non-zero elements, that will give me a plan. That will indicate where I have to add the blocks. For example, let's look at a depth-first ordering of this guy and the first non-zero element, which is this one right here. Okay, that one falls in N11. I go and add a block in N11. Next non-zero element, N21, here, right here. I go and add a block in N21, and so forth. Okay. By the time I'm done with this, I have a partial structure already built. Notice how we have created most of the final configuration, except for this entry point that ramps up to the central tower. So the next event tree is a smaller event tree because not every The next event tree corresponds to the second interval of every node, but then not every node has a second interval, in which case I'm just going to ignore them. So the ones that have a second interval are just this subtree in the original tree. And once again, I build the support structure much like before, and except this time they're representing removal of nodes instead of addition of nodes. I do the depth first ordering again. This time, you know, whenever I come across the non-first elements, I just remove the blocks from there. I get this structure. Finally, the last event tree, when I parse it in depth first ordering, I get my final structure. Okay. So the formal proofs for all this is in the paper, of course. Okay, so the outer loop. The outer loop, a few words about this. So in the outer loop, we just have to search for a good tree to furnish for the inner loop. And so for example, there's an entire space of trees out there, but let me speak about two specific trees. The minimum spanning tree is one of them. The minimum spanning tree essentially comes out of, so this edge, for example, right? So what is the weight on this edge? The weight on this edge is going to be just the difference in the heights of those corresponding of the endpoint locations. So that edge will have a weight of 1. This edge will have a weight of 3, okay, because blanks represent zeros here, okay? So I can create the minimum spanning tree, which intuitively captures a set of inroads into the architecture of the structure with minimum height variations. And there's also, in the paper, I've spoken about a reweighted minimum spanning tree, which I'm not going to go into the details of it here, but you can look it up. In practice, it does a little bit better than the minimum spanning tree. But the point is that there's an entire space of trees that one can explore in the outer loop. All right, so let me show you some empirical results here. Well, first of all, we have to be able to compare our algorithms with something. So let me speak about two approaches that we use for comparison. One is the tower-by-tower approach, which is really the most naive approach, where for every tower that we want to construct, we construct the ramp for it and then totally deconstruct it, all right? Now, a more intelligent approach is the row-by-row approach, where here we kind of take a given problem instance and complete it one row at a time. But then within any row, we make use of synergies between adjacent towers. For example, when I construct the tower for 5 using a ramp in this direction, after this tower is constructed, I don't deconstruct the ramp because this 4, the ramp already provides for this 4 here. So I make use of synergies within each row, right? And this, of course, is a much better strategy than this one. And most humans actually think of the row-by-row approach for completing. All right, so we tested our algorithms on models of world-famous buildings as well as on random instances and other handcrafted examples and so forth. So these are just cool pictures that we have of the various buildings. That's the Empire State Building, Eiffel Tower, and Disney Hall, and so forth. And what we found is that the minimum spanning tree works, and the reweighted minimum spanning tree, they work really well. Tower by tower is not even in the picture here, really. So let's look at just the comparison with row by row. Often it takes just about half the number of, between 45 and 60% of the operations on blocks compared to row by row approach. So here is a more exhaustive table on random instances. So these are all 10 cross 10 matrices with a maximum height of 15. The percentage column here indicates the percentage of locations that are marked off to be empty. And as you can see, this trend continues. RMST takes only about 45 to 60% of block operations compared to something that a human would think about, typically the row-by-row approach. And also another trend that emerges from the set of data here is that as the percentage of empty locations increases, the tendency to form more and more disconnected regions in the structure also increases. And it is in those cases where RMST begins to outperform MST, where RMST kind of still is able to find out some backbones that are going to be relevant for disjoint parts of the structure. All right, so let me conclude by saying that the Harvard Termus Project is really a great meeting ground for robotics and planning folks. And for our current best approach that we could conceive of for planning for the Termus domain is the tree-based dynamic programming approach. And of course, for future work, I mean, this is really just very open-ended. I mean, there are all kinds of issues that we want to address. The issue of multiple robot coordination, how about having slightly different objective functions and non-uniform block sizes, and hollow enclosures instead of solid enclosures, and I mean, instead of solid structures and roofs and everything. So that's about it. I'll leave it here and take some questions.
So this, you've come up with a method which is in some sense domain specific to termes.
Right.
Right. And it looks like, you know, while this is a very clever method, if you were to change one little thing, like make the robot two squares long instead of one, so that he had to have a ramp that was two blocks, and it takes a platform of four to actually turn. Mm-hmm. Right, that, you know, that's the kind of thing that would totally screw up your domain.
Well, I don't believe that to be the case, because yes, the algorithm is particular to this particular domain, but the principle of doing search on trees to capture this locality, right? So the locality principle is essentially captured using the tree-based dynamic programming approach, and that would be, that's a fairly generic principle. That can be extended to other domains as well. But how exactly we build the support structure in the event trees, yes, that is very specific to the problem domain. Yeah.
Okay. Another question?
Actually, my question is related to David's question. So you claim that domain-independent planners don't work efficiently on the problem, and therefore you exploit domain-specific structure. So did you consider ever using like hierarchical planners for this problem? Because it seems like you have this knowledge that you can potentially encode using, let's say, something like HTN methods. And in fact, your decomposition, the tree that you generate looks suspiciously close to like HTN decomposition trees. So can you comment on this?
Well, I don't know how much of those techniques would be able to defeat the fact that these are really, really long plans. I haven't particularly looked into the HTN style of doing it.
For instance,
the Towers of Hanoi problem, right, can be solved very efficiently with HTN planners, and they are exponential in the size, the length of the optimal plan is exponential in the size of the problem.
Sure.
So they can, yeah. But yeah, just something to look into.
Okay.
Last question.
So can you go back to one of your trees?
Okay, the event tree? Or
yeah, the event tree.
Okay.
So I actually wanted to disagree that it looks like an HTN tree, because to me, to me, what it looks like is the parent is not a super task. The parent is actually a precondition.
Correct.
Right? And so there's like some causal structure represented in your tree, which might get back to Dave's question about, can we generalize this for more causal type reasoning within more general plans?
Yeah, I'm hoping that, you know, there is this principle of doing search on using dynamic programming on trees that span your kind of the footprint. That could be probably extensible to other domains as well. But yes, for this, the support structure itself is very domain specific. So.
Thank you again.
All right. Thank you.